My ears are gone now, but that's fine.
Welcome to another episode of the Gettin' Salty Experience. It's the only podcast, Carol, that brings the kitchen table you guys right there, bro. We got a really great show tonight.
The best show.
The best show.
We'll see.
We've got the Gies family. But before we get to the Gies family, as always, I got my partner, Louis Ruffy.
What's up, Fano?
Excellent.
Golf clap.
Golf clap.
Thank you.
We've got producer Pete, a.k.a. Proby Pete.
Shabbat shalom. Hello on this beautiful Sabbath.
Before we get to anything, we got to talk about the word of the day, bro. And the word of the day is...
We have a whole bit we have to do first.
What do we get first?
You're rushing.
We have to sell. This is the problem. We're rushing again. We gotta make this money.
The shameless plug.
We gotta make it.
All right. And you know, and that you guys know what time it is, and it's time to talk about gettinsaltyapparel.com, where you can find beautiful t-shirts like mine right here. But what else can they find, Bobby?
You can find a nice quality double stitched mask. First through to your old lady's box. Oh, right there, double stitch, good quality.
Double stitch.
Wait, great quality.
You're not going to find a quality.
Breathability.
Excellent.
Excellent.
Excellent quality breathing. I love it. Yeah. And just remember, I'm first through to your old lady's box.
Oh,
there you go. It's a message. It's a message selling here, guys. So gettinsaltyapparel.com, guys. That's how we pay the bills around here. And if you want to support the show, support us at gettinsaltyapparel.com.
If you want cigar cutters, like this one, bro, right here, this. Boys,
take it a feed.
I can't feel my face.
Can't feel my face. Been here since
5 o'clock.
We finally starting to start drinking
cigar cutters.
Louis, you got to hit this.
Pull up to your mic a little bit, Louis.
Bottle top off.
Bring that up.
Nozzle bottle top open.
Wow. Louis, it's your first time?
Wow.
You're getting yelled at by Proby Pete.
25 episodes in this, and he's just learning. Yeah. That's good.
Talk into your mic, Louis. All right. So let's introduce our guests right here. We have a whole family right here. We have the Gies family.
Nice.
Right, Carol? How's that, bro?
Perfect.
You love it?
She yelled at you.
She did love it. She did yell at me. Yep. We got the Gies family. And why the Gies family is special to us is... because Louie and I, when we became members of Squad Company 288, Trotter members, we got to work with their dad, Ronnie Gies, who was, at the time, a senior man to us, right, bro?
He was a senior man.
He was a senior man to us.
He came from 308. Then.
I think he had about 14 years from 308, somewhere around there. He was a senior man to us. We had maybe
4 or 5.
Anywhere between 2 and 5 years on the job. And he was our senior man, and the best part was he used to bring these three schlubs right here. How old were they? How old were you guys when you guys came to the firehouse first?
Before I ask that, Pete, do I look fat on camera?
Not at all.
I don't look fat.
I'm getting crazy.
No. Because I want everyone to know that camera adds 30 pounds.
Camera adds 30 pounds.
All right, cameras are I just wanted to get that out there for all the listeners. It's the camera.
It's all about the lighting.
The camera is 10 pounds. The TV at Bradford Street must add at least 15 pounds, boys.
Bradford Street?
Bradford Street. That's in Staten Island.
I think Staten Island. Somewhere in Staten Island, Brad.
By the Verrazano. By the
I think if you go right over the Verrazano and you go, you keep going to the Outer Bridge Crossing, you'll hit Bradford
Let's
Street.
That's how stupid Ronnie was to get promoted to Bradford
Street. That'll actually bring you to Trenton.
Oh! Carol Gies throwing one right in there, bro.
I figured this was going to happen if you attacked the boys. She's going to come swooping in. Yeah, you're going to swoop in.
Mama Goose.
Swooping in.
How you doing?
The chat is really angry. Someone said that if the camera adds 30 pounds, you must have 4 cameras on your phone.
Right. That's all right. I respect that.
Hold on. Listen,
COVID just happened. The gyms were closed. Come on. What's the matter with you?
As soon as you start defending that, you know, you got them like this. Look at me like this.
My shirts are large.
I got good hair. Good hair. I'm
sticking with my hair.
Go with the hair.
Dude, all you guys got good hair, bro. I gotta say.
There's only one of us that doesn't have gray hair, though.
Let's talk about that.
That would be you.
That
would be Ronnie.
Yep.
Yeah.
Ronnie, you got it.
Bobby, Ricky, and Mike. If I love the girl, who cares who he's watching?
I got the cover.
All right, so let's get this one. Okay, so we came to Squad Company 288. in 1998, and Ronnie was the senior man. And what he would do was he would bring these three young lads right here. How old were you guys when you first came to the final?
12.
16.
Yeah. He was 16.
Yeah. He was maybe 16.
13.
12.
12 years old.
No.
I was 15.
You were younger than
I was 98. I was 15.
You were 15.
Yeah.
Back in the day.
He was 13, and he was 12.
11.
11. Dude.
Bob sucks at math, so he's in 12.
I'm not
12.
I'm going to put a moron.
I'm good at math. No, I was 12 when 9/11 happened.
Bob still cares. No,
before that.
Right. 11. You were 11
years old when your dad used to bring you to the firehouse, and me and Ruffy were firemen there with your dad. And give me a little perspective of what was going on at the time when you guys first came to the firehouse.
Oh, it was unbelievable. I was, you know.
Hey, just pull that mic up to you.
Yeah.
There you go.
We were
put the mic in your mouth.
It was pretty impressive. We were definitely, I mean, I definitely had aspirations to get on the job, and watching you guys at the time was definitely definitely what polished off wanting to getting on the job. You guys made that firehouse a lot of fun and definitely very entertaining to watch, and watching my father try to control it was one of the even more entertaining things I think I've ever seen. But yeah, I remember coming in a bunch. My father like asking me to come in because I said I wanted to be a fireman, and he always wanted to make sure that's what I wanted to do. And you know, as we get later on the timeline, we'll tell a story of.
If he starts telling war stories, I'm going to go to sleep.
Yeah, the different. Hold on, the
I'm
difference.
I'm
going
to go to
is,
war stories. I'm going to go to sleep.
So while Tommy wanted to become a fireman, I had zero interest.
Really?
Early on. Early on. Zero interest.
In those days. At that
those
time.
Days. So my dad would force me to come to work. He'd be like,
because
you know,
he knew.
I would send him probably, with his father.
And now I look back. And
I
like,
could see.
You know, I look back and I'm like, you know, I used to check the book and be like, wow, these groups suck.
Not what I was working on.
So my dad probably looked and he would see Kubler, Refrano, and he'd be like, wow, these groups suck. Ronnie, you're coming to work tonight. So he would force me in. He would force me to come to work.
Probably because
and
he knew
I remember
he'd never finished college.
Let me ask
I
you this. Would he need the force job. You to say the word of the day ever?
I'd show up and he'd be like,
time out.
Ronnie,
the word of the day
is?
The word of the day, ladies and gentlemen, is? Fucko.
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 His favorite Ronnie. Word. We His were all fuckos.
He used to use that.
He used that word all
the time. All the time.
So go ahead, bro.
So I would.
Who are you, Bobby?
Ronnie.
Oh, Ronnie.
You know who I am.
Whatever.
It's been a long day already.
We've been drinking since 5.
Go ahead, naturally.
Go ahead, Tommy.
So he'd say, "Yeah, you're coming to work tonight." And I'd be like, "I got no interest." He'd be like, "Oh, it's good to know you're coming to work tonight." So I'd go in and he'd make me come to work, and that's how I met you guys. And you know the. I remember you two. I remember a lot of the guys. I really remember, and I hope he's retired by now. The
easy,
big guy.
Easy.
Easy. He's definitely retired by now.
All right, go ahead.
I'm sure enough that I'll go through with the story. The big guy with the fucking real hairy back.
Oh
Billy Quick.
Billy Quickie, man.
My first experience at 288. My dad sends me into the locker room. He's like, "Hey, go get this from my locker." I'm like, What are your legs broken? Go get it yourself. He's like, he gives me the look. My dad gave me that look. He usually followed with the good old backhand. So I went and I walked through his locker, and there's Billy Quick on all fours,
totally
completely
naked
through the locker room. And I'm like, holy shit, now I really don't want to be a fireman. What goes on in this place?
That's funny. We're talking about Ronnie with Billy Quick with a hairy back.
Yeah.
Today.
You got your back
I
shaved.
I got my bro. Back shaved.
You did.
I got my back
you
shaved.
Paid to have your back
one,
shaved,
20
bro.
Bucks, got my back
one
shaved.
One of the things that we discussed while we were here.
Right. I got my back shaved. I thought it was a little weird, but maybe not so weird after all.
Wait a minute. See, what I do is I have my young guys, like 9, 8, and 9. My little guy shaves my back.
I don't have a little guy. So I had to pay the barber. I thought
you
it was
paid
weird.
The wait, barber wait. To shave your
What's
back.
Her name?
Well, it was his name. And then he asked me to go in the bathroom to do it. I got nervous.
Whoa!
I left the door open.
We'll stop right there. We'll stop right there, bro. We'll leave it right there.
Yeah.
So you got your back shaved.
Yeah. But that's what I remember going to work with the old man.
Yeah, Quickie
Billy
was.
Quick, rest in peace.
Billy Quick.
Yeah, he ended up
passing
away. He passed away not too long ago.
You are right.
A couple years ago. But he was.
May he rest in peace.
He was always naked. He always looked like a Sasquatch.
he was always on all fours.
He always used to, when we first got to the mat, when we first got to the squad, the mat was really a lot of old timers there that kind of were on the way out of the job. And, you know, we came in with a lot of piss and vinegar. And, you know, Quickie was, he was one of the senior guys. He was, it was Quick. It was Hank Molay.
Ronnie Gies,
you know, for the most part, those were the three guys that really kept, and Jerry Murph, there was a couple of guys that really, Murph didn't say much, but when he talked, you listened, right?
Yep.
Whereas Quickie was always talking, and, you know, he would do this thing where, I mean,
act
I think
like an ape.
He would act like a...
He would come into the kitchen.
Totally naked. Everybody's naked. Eating breakfast. Like, it would be like 15 people, and he would come in and do this thing with his arms and like go up against the cabinets, and then he would jump on the table.
And I'm only going to say it because I know he'd be okay with it. Didn't he do it through Neary's backyard once? Yeah.
He did do that.
While Katie was doing
this. Yeah. Dude, he was always thinking. He did that.
That man traveled to Merrick.
I told.
He traveled to run through Neary's backyard naked. On all fours like an ape naked.
Dude, he was a mountain climber.
He was a professional.
He was a mountain climber, right? One of the strongest guys. He would do this stuff with cables, like all sorts of crazy stuff. I told his story. He was in like somewhere in the Northwest, in Washington or Oregon. He was in the mountains, and they were in the middle of nowhere. And there were a couple of guys. He told us his story. He was like camp, you know, at the campfire. And every once in a while, a car would pass. So one of the guys says, dude, you know what you should do? Strip down. Run across the road right when the car's coming and see what happens, right? You would look like a Sasquatch, right? So he does this, right? You know, of course, over there, they, you know, they're running around with pickup trucks with a, you know, a 30-30 hanging in the back window, right? So the guy goes, he runs across. The guy's like, this is the way Quickie told the story. The guy slams on the brake. He's like, did you hear that? You see that there? You know, just fucking squatch. You know, like next thing you know, the guy's jumping out of the car. You know, he's doing this thing. He's like, all his friends come running out. No, dude, he's all friends. You know, like, so, but he was always naked. He always used to shave his back. He used to shave squat 288 in his back. You know,
we would shave squat 288.
That's loyalty, right?
Yeah, he loved being there. It was a lot of fun. It was a lot of pride.
You know, shaving Bradford Street.
Where is Bradford Street again?
I think it's Staten Island.
Staten Island, Arizona.
You know where it is? First duty, old ladies.
Oh! No!
Good job, fuck up. Oh!
I always like fuckface better.
I got a good fucko story.
Oh, hold on.
You want a fucko story?
Oh, you got a good one?
Yeah. I got a real good one. So they decided that it was necessary to name the block we grew up on right next door to you, Lexington Avenue, to in honor of the old man.
Right.
Whoever decided, I don't know, the town. So it was a big to-do, naturally. And so as a family, they never let me speak because I always was inappropriate.
No.
You know, the post.
Maybe a little bit retarded. But retarded,
yeah.
Should we thank the captain of friendship for letting us have us here, Gerard Huck?
Yeah, how you doing?
Gerard, captain, thank you for letting us be here.
Shameless plug.
Thank you.
So anyway, so they never let me speak. You know, the eulogy, the this, the that. It was always Bobby. It was Tommy. It was Bobby. It was my mom.
I'm a great public speaker.
Good for you.
And they were like, oh, you backseat. So now they decide we're going to name the street after the old man. So they're like, oh. I'm like, I want to speak. So the whole community turns out. The priest. So I get up there. I write my speech. I show no one because naturally they would have told me no chance. Bad idea. And the first thing I say.
Is this going to go bad right now?
This is going to go real bad. It went real bad then.
No, like right now it's going to go bad?
No, it's going to go all right now. It's a long time ago. You know, you're talking. What are we, 2020? You're talking 18 years ago.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
There you go, Pete.
Thank you, Pete.
So I get to the mic and I say, welcome, everyone. I mean, I'm going to call you all fuckos. How you doing?
So it's going to go good. It's going to go good.
Right
there.
Everyone had no idea. I said it.
No shit.
No one had a clue what to do. And actually, that day, a man dropped dead.
That's another good
one. Yeah. No joke. Someone actually died at the ceremony. So that right? Because I said,
so it was good. Now it's not so good.
True story. It went from good to not so good. Was true he, story. Pete, someone died.
What just happened?
Mel hit his head.
Oh! Oh!
Oh! Way to break that up, Pete. Rest in peace to Eddie Holmes. That's the man who died that day.
You didn't bring him back?
No, no, they tried. No good.
So he's on. Available for
do you, do you, this, this is what I wanted to know. I wanted to know
take if him off
you
the have his hours no longer count.
Do you actually have you know the hat I'm going to talk about, right? The hat, the first hat we ever made when we became the squad. We didn't know shit. We didn't have any shirts. We didn't have the big B with the American flag. Wait, we had nothing.
Did you have masks?
We didn't have any masks. Double stitch. We didn't have any of that. Right. So we came up with. We went down to the. Down the road, we went to the store and, to the screen printing guy, and we got hats and shirts made up, right? And the guy brought us this hat. It was Squad 288.
Yellow.
But it was a blue hat.
Right, blue hat.
With the gold, never yellow, gold. And it was like, it was about, hold on, it was about this high, right? It was like a locomotive guy, right? Like,
and only one man made it look
and,
good.
And everybody went like this. Everybody went like this. Oh, great, I'm going to buy a hat. They were like this. Whoop.
Except
the one man.
Ronnie Gies
wore that hat every day.
He sucked right.
I don't know if it came with the mustache. I don't know if it had the perfect.
Came with a cap.
Do we have a picture? Do we have a picture of that?
Do we have a picture of that, Pete?
That's the hat.
Let me see if I can find it.
No,
that's the hat.
Hold on.
Louis, that's the hat. I just turned it into a cool hat.
That's the gold one. That's a black.
He actually bent the brim.
That one.
Was that the hat?
No, that's not the hat.
Ronnie.
Someone should run around the corner.
We
right
should.
Now.
I should have looked for it. No, that's Ronnie there.
That's a helmet. Oh, that's a handsome that's a devil. Piece. Look at that.
He is a handsome devil.
You're not kidding.
He's look
not.
At me. Look. Rawr, Carol. Rawr.
I think you know what? You said you looked most like
Vic sleeping.
I think he looks most like you, bro.
No, just recently in a picture, people thought it was Ronnie and it was Tommy.
Well, anyway,
mustache, which for the record was phenomenal.
He wore that hat just better than I'm telling you. And he had the hair, he had the good hair, kind of like these guys all have the good hair.
Who's got the best hair?
I mean, you got the good hair.
I got a haircut today.
Yeah,
this is my hair, but for the record, what's wrong with mine?
What's wrong with mine?
It's just good.
It's a little.
Your hair is beautiful. But I also think that Ronnie, I think that thing came with a wig. I don't know. Ronnie had a wig on that thing, bro.
He had the mustache, he always had the hat. And that's right. One thing I always remember about him. Me and too. He broke my balls.
Trucker
I
mean, hat.
Somebody and a smile.
It wasn't. It was like a trucker
I'm telling you, Louis, that's the hat.
I'll go back.
That's got to be the hat.
Right here.
Right there.
Well,
right. Dude. Boom. That's not the hat, though.
No, no,
that's
a helmet.
Front piece.
That's his helmet.
That's the front piece.
Although the hat was that high.
Because it's still yellow. One thing about Ronnie. Geez.
Thank you.
Wow. You said that nicely.
Oh, I got some about Ronnie.
Here's the thing. No matter what happened, like we talked about being the squad, his whole thing was being the best engine in the 14th
division.
He did want
to be an
engine.
And
he used to say this, engine.
Engine.
Yeah.
Engine.
Right?
He never said engine.
His mother said engine.
Engine.
He said
engine.
He said engine.
Kev, where's the 14th division?
Really?
You know what he's like this? He's like this for Seville right now. He's like this. Cap, I got you, Cap.
Hold on.
I've done this before.
Hold on, Seville.
Sorry,
just, Carol, Seville just texted
I don't
me.
Care about
Seville texted me.
I never heard of him.
280 late.
Where is
how you doing?
Oh, I got a couple of Seville stories. Oh, we'll get to it.
Hey, listen to me. Tell Seville we'll first do it as all of these boxes. Right there, bro. I'm gonna tell you right now. Ronnie taught me more about engine work.
Engine work.
Engine work.
Than any fireman whoever taught me about engine work right there. I used to make sure that when he was driving, he was the chauffeur, I would take care of him. I would clean the windows.
He was crazy.
I swear to God, I would do everything to make sure that his life was easy, bro. I would check the pumps. I would clean the windows on the rig. I would make sure everything. And he appreciated it, bro, because he was all about being the best engine in the 14th division.
We had on the engine on the chauffeur's compartment. He made the board that had all the fittings
for correct.
To hook up to whatever right. You had a double male, a double female, yep. You know, the increaser, exactly decreaser. Like yeah, it was the same. He was the one who really set
it
that
here,
up
right?
Before he had it on the
yeah, he set that up.
Transferred to here. Same exact
he did.
Right.
It was One thing I wanted to ask, you know, this is one thing that really sticks out to me about Ronnie. Was he always like the, you know, 26 years on the job, I have like three of the top three snorers ever.
And that motherfucker.
Ronnie was on. He's definitely number two. He like locked it.
He's up there.
Was he always number one? Was he the worst snorer ever? Like, I wanted to ask him.
I didn't know he slept at work.
Oh, really?
He rested between his fronts.
Yeah. Oh, look at the second alone.
Oh, the, hold on. The rules of the show. Don't throw anyone under the bus.
Who are you throwing under the bus?
Actually, because he said you threw him under the bus.
Nah. Oh, he slept at work. He slept at work. His
wait
wife,
a minute.
His wife never thought he slept at work.
Yeah.
He rested between runs. Oh. He rested between runs, bro.
Pete, if we're going to throw people under the bus, I got on the comments here that Ronnie is stealing up the show, that he has the most camera space being taken up at this time.
I don't.
And that's coming up from 175 there.
Hey, who's
175?
Ronnie?
Which one's is Ronnie? That his neck?
Are you Ronnie?
Wait,
are you
Bobby? Ronnie? Where's 175? JT, there you go. I got you, buddy.
Where's 175? Let me make a quick adjustment.
I think that's a fish store. Do they sell fish there? What do they got?
175.
What do they do?
What do they do?
Rapid Street's the company that shows up to save POSA.
How you doing, bro?
I was going to hold this one, but I'm going to give this one to
go ahead.
Get right out there, bro.
I'm not scared. Captain Seville, he'll remember this.
He's watching.
He's watching
all right.
Captain Seville is a captain of 175 truck. At that time, he was in 332.
Where is that? Is that now?
That's a fish store.
Fish store. Oh.
They love the guy.
Great, great fish sandwich.
He always
there,
one of my
you
favorite
love him. I love my I father. Love you heard that, Cap?
He was one of my favorite guys. You know, and as he knew, you know, when it came to that, it was always a little bit, you know how it is on the job. But I always loved him. I always respected him. He's a great guy. So I was telling this story earlier. We were going down Pennsylvania, report of a fire in a commercial. So as I'm coming down Pennsylvania towards Linden. Now
where were you working at the time?
Fire factory.
290.
Oh, I wasn't 290 at the time. I wasn't 290. I was 290. 90. I gave it as 290. I was.
Yep, 290.
So as I'm coming, he was in 332. As I'm coming down, I could see fire coming off of like a McDonald's or a Wendy's or whatever the heck it was.
You saw fire? You saw smoke?
I never ate McDonald's.
Fire
before.
20, 30 feet off the roof, right? So, of course, I'm like, yes. And I'm like, 290 various comments.
You gave the urgent. It was bad, right?
So I go, he probably was laughing at this right now. So I'm like, 290 to Brooklyn, real calm. Go ahead, 290. Yeah, 1075.
No,
fire through the roof. Urgent. 290 urgent. I gave an urgent. So, of course, we get there. I go into the store, to McDonald's. There's people eating Big Macs and cheeseburgers. They're hanging out. They don't know what's going on. I'm like, everybody out, you know? Like, so we start poking holes, and there's nothing. And then I get this little feeling in my gut. Like, I'm like, oh, my God, you know? And so the guys get the ladders up. It turns out it's like, I don't know, an air conditioner, a motor, some type of motor that's on fire. That's, you know, they put it out in 2 seconds, right? So I come down. I go, ended up running up the ladder to see what was going on. I was hoping it was in the cockloft, something, anything, you know? So I come down, and Seville is there. And he's like, hey, Louie, nice job on the urgent. I was just like this. I was like this. Oh, my God. I never gave an urgent ever again.
That's it.
Never one time. And
I do have to say. 175, one of the greatest firehouses on the job. Ronnie is a complete idiot for getting promoted out of there.
What?
I have to say it.
How you doing?
I was 100% dedicated.
Well, now you're in a great spot.
Oh, he's bouncing around somewhere.
He's bouncing.
Captain Seville. I told him not to take the promotion.
Let's bring it back a little bit. Let's bring it back. So we're in 288. These three right here come in. How old are you guys when we come in?
I think 11, 13, and 15.
Right.
So and the 15-year-old is the only one that ever wanted to be a fireman.
Okay. So you guys come in.
I'm still confused what I want to do.
You do.
And mind you, at 11, he was confused with his sexuality also.
We don't want to go there. Not going to go there.
Yikes.
That might have been too much.
What's that, baby?
I said, do you see why we never let Ronnie speak?
Yeah, I can see it.
That happened quickly.
Shut his mic.
And hold on. You're liked over there?
I was liked.
I mean, in Bradford Street, you were liked.
The boys are watching.
I know, but did they really like?
I was liked. I'm missed.
You're missed.
Missed.
I'm missed.
Mm. Let's get back.
I'm missed.
Let's back it up.
When you guys come into the squad,
I missed like AIDS at Bradford Street.
Oh, would you be quiet?
You missed like the COVID.
High five.
Let's get back to like 1999, 2000, when you guys are kids and you're coming at the firehouse, right? How old are you again?
Say it again.
11, 13,
15.
So you guys come into the firehouse, and me and Ruffy, a fireman, with your dad in the firehouse. What is it like? Give me something. Give me a little story.
I'll be honest. I don't think I went to the firehouse that young.
You don't remember?
No, what? I don't. I don't think I went.
You know what? Hold on. Let me.
I was the favorite at home, so I didn't have to go with them at work.
That's what happened.
I was the favorite at home.
It's the truth.
I was the favorite at home.
Okay.
But there's a reason.
Leave you out of the equation.
Were you guys?
You two guys.
Get on the volley.
Come to the firehouse.
You were. I had just. I got on the volleys at 18, and. I was that's when I started college, and I was going to John Jay to study fire science, where, you know, that's where I went. And that's when I really started going a bunch. And he was basically trying to make sure it was definitely what I wanted to do.
Right.
And it wasn't really a tough sell going into 288 and seeing the great group of guys that was there when, you know, back then. And but I mean, I rode a bunch with you guys when I was younger. Definitely saw some decent work up there.
A man who loved his job.
That was the big thing.
He loved it. He loved going to work.
Yep.
So how could they go not there and not love being there?
So give me some stories about when you came.
So
and us two assholes.
I remember I came in one night, and you two working. It was whatchamacallit. You two. It was Matt Neary. Hunter was working.
John.
My father and Vinny Ungaro was the boss. Oh, and God. It's pretty sad to mention that crew right now, actually.
Let's cheers to Vinny Ungaro.
Vinny Ungaro.
Cheers.
But,
A great man.
I remember nothing was going on. We never run probably the first 4 or 5 hours of a night tour. And my father, I'll never forget, he looked at me and goes, "Hey, someday eat the chicken." And before he could even get all the days he eat the feathers out, the tone alarm went off and they were filling out a box. 138 was actually first due. And around the block here, another friend of mine, Chris Pryor's father, who's now Mike Pryor, was a senior man in 138, happened to be driving 138 that day. And I kind of like wandered off the rig. It was a private dwelling going pretty good. I wandered off the rig, and Mike Pryor, he looks at me and goes, basically like, "The fuck are you doing here?" I'm like, "I was riding with my dad." He goes, "Get in the rig and don't move." And I remember like just
wandering the street,
like sitting there, in Corona, Queens, at 18 years old, like a white Merrick boy, no clue what's going on. And I remember sitting there, watched the whole thing, and we went back afterwards. He's like, "What'd you think?" I was like, "I think Mike Pryor is a pretty scary guy." And then, I was telling you guys before, I rode two nights before 9/11 with my father.
And, I was working that night.
You both were working that night. And I remember he called me. I had literally just started John Jay. We had went like 3 days before into Manhattan to make my class schedule. And he was like, definitely looking to make sure, like, all right, you're going to school for fire science. This isn't what you're going to do. Change colleges, change your major. And I remember that night we had a blast. There was allegedly a small food fight in the kitchen involving some donuts. One individual.
Might have happened. Could have happened.
Maybe. I'm not 100% sure.
I heard it happen.
I went home the next morning, and I remember him calling me like, "What'd you think?" I was like, I think I know what I'm doing. I can't wait till they give a test. And then 2 days later, it was pretty much set in stone.
Yeah,
I really wasn't interested in doing it. After 9/11, I definitely wasn't going to do anything else.
I mean, I know I've said this on the podcast. I know we've talked about Ronnie before, but I don't even know if you guys know that. But that day, my daughter, so if that was September 9th or 8th, I don't even know what night.
You're going to miss.
That was the eighth night into the ninth day.
Right. So that day, my daughter was going to be one September 21st, right? She was going to have her first birthday. And you guys were there. I don't know if the two of you were there, if you were just there, I don't remember. But I remember him sitting me down, like we were drinking coffee in the morning, and he said something. And I mean, listen, that's no bullshit. I'm not, this is exactly what he told me. You know, guys tell you a lot of shit over the years. Mm-hmm. Some stuff you remember, some stuff you don't. And he told me, don't ever tell your kids tomorrow, right? No shit. So you think about that, right? Here's a guy, I said that, you know, I tell that to people now. Yeah. And, you know, I don't think about, you know, a couple days later that that's going to hold true because, you know, the kid wants to play baseball, you know, play catch. And you right. say, tomorrow. yeah, tomorrow I'll take care. You know, we'll do it tomorrow. While I got him too busy. And he was telling me that because I was a brand new father. Right.
He was a big never say goodbye guy. He always said, see you later to everybody.
Right.
Never said goodbye. And I mean, you never understood it as a kid, but obviously you realized what he was getting at. Now I.
Yeah.
Literally don't think I've ever said goodbye to anybody since.
Yeah, and I tell that story. I tell that to people. I tell that to people now, you know, because it's hard to fight that, right? Everybody's busy.
Absolutely.
Right? Everybody's got shit to do. And, absolutely. You know, the kids are coming and going. They're on the fucking phone, whatever it is, they're doing shit. And, you know, you almost have to fight to get them to go play ball you know, I got two girls. So it's, you know, it's even worse. You know what I mean? They don't want to do shit, right? So it's like, I'm trying to get them involved in soccer, anything, you know, just to get him out.
We're getting mushy. Yeah.
You know, I knew. I'm just saying. I knew if I was going to pick the one guy, it was going to be the Bradford Street guy. I knew it was going to be a problem.
Exactly.
Right? Even your mother said
I got a good.
Your mother.
The truth is, if you ever need a mask, we got a good double stitch mask.
Let me say one thing about Ronnie, but. Ronnie taught me more about being an engine chauffeur.
Oh, what?
Engine chauffeur. He taught me more about being an engine chauffeur than anybody on the job, bro. The pride he had for being a first-two engine chauffeur.
You're having trouble with that.
Was far beyond anybody who ever taught me anything about being.
You know, it's funny. I went to the truck at a probie school and.
Legacy truck. How you doing?
I would look across the floor and I joked, you know, after I had a couple of years and I was friendly with guys and you can actually talk. I joked like I know more about that side of the floor without a doubt than I know about the truck. And guys would be like, what do you mean? You're in the truck. You're not learning anything. I was like, no, I'm learning plenty. I couldn't be possibly learning more. This is a great house. The senior guys are teaching me nonstop, but I literally grew up having that beaten into my head from 16 up.
What house is that, Tom?
Hold on. I work in a 147 truck.
Let's be honest here. 147.
Your mother's breaking your balls.
147 is across the street.
Hold on.
Let's be honest here.
But
Tommy was in probie school. Okay. While Tommy was in probie school, I was in the prime of my, like, you know,
college
dad,
years.
Something.
Dad died drinking.
Oh boy.
Era. I would wake him up every night.
Me getting
fireworks.
Through Kobe school was a miracle.
You go to bed at 8 p.m. Now,
what's you and I?
What year is this? What year did you get on?
I got on in 2004.
Time drop. So, how you doing?
Yeah. Hold on. I got to pick my
you
time card.
You got a time
up.
Drop button? You should. Hit the horn. Time drop. Gary. There you go.
I would get up at 4:30 in the morning, walk out the door at 5 o'clock probie school, he'd be in my mother's hot tub with all of his friends drinking
right.
still.
And we're going here.
I would.
Oh, I didn't know we were going down this road.
Oh yeah. And I would literally walk out the door.
Making a hard left. We're going hard.
I would walk out the door
down that road. We gotta fucking work, bro. The brothers are going to work. Before we go down that road, if you need a double stitch, high quality mask, 32-year-old lady.
What is going
How
on?
How you doing?
Can you
but back to but I'm sorry.
Anyway, Tommy difficult. Got assigned to 147.
Where's across that? The street from a hummus
Where's
shop.
That? It's,
hummus
it's,
shop.
It's actually naturally across the street from Mimi's hummus shop.
True story.
True
but,
story.
For the record, I did transmit a 1075 in the basement of Mimi's on the show.
They did work.
Yeah, true story.
When he got there, they did work. Nowadays,
we're still doing plenty.
We'll let it be. But, you know, when he got assigned,
where he wanted to go, where he went.
All that's not true.
Oh, we're going. You're going hard left.
Oh, you're going hard left.
Should I bring the mask up again?
Who exactly is texting you all this? All right,
listen. What's the next question? What do we got? Cut him off.
Can you hit a button? Brody
Pete.
Nicely done.
Pete, are you supposed to hit a button? Thank you.
That one. Right, so you want to talk about, let's talk about.
I got a great story about when I rode with my dad, though.
All right, this is what I want to hear. I don't want to hear about that other shit.
I know that, you know, I'm getting crazy texts from the boys from Bradford Street.
Put the phone down, Sabrina. Sabrina, put the phone down.
What do you mean, Karen?
Sabrina, you put the phone down.
The phone's blowing up. The boys from Bradford Street watching, but.
Turn it over.
I'll be Buffy for a minute. I'll turn the phone over.
Thank you.
So one night, my dad, one day, actually, it was a day tour. My dad told me, like I said, he must have looked at the groups and he said, oh, shit, Kuba's working. Raffano's working. And he grabbed me and he's like, you're coming to work. And I was like, Dad, I don't want to go to work. He's like, no, you're coming to work. So I went to work because that's how it worked in the Gies family. When he spoke, we listened.
Mm-hmm. Not me.
No more. You know, 2020, I speak, my kids don't listen. But anyway, I went to work and I show up to 88 and midday, we have lunch, nice lunch. Don't remember what it is, but
not good.
Probably not good.
Peanut butter and jelly sandwich.
Probably not good. Oh, the squad never has time to make a good lunch, you know?
So busy.
Heavy fire duty.
Heavy fire duty. Calling along for fire. I get on the rig, and back in the day, the first 288 rig, you guys could tell me, is probably a Mac, right?
Yep. Yeah.
So the Mac, I sat up front.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
There's a bench, yep.
It was a bench seat, and I'm not going to lie, I wish I remember who the boss was, but the old man was driving. I sat in the middle, and whoever the boss was, I'd be lying if I said I knew who it was, I don't remember, sat in the middle, turn out, we fucking show up, and it's the first new job. And now,
go ahead.
288, first new job. How you doing?
Odds are everyone remembers this.
So I'm like, holy shit. And the old man beats the rig on a curb. So the first new truck, we got in first. The truck wasn't in yet. So he put the rig, and I hate telling fire stories. And the boys from Bradford Street.
I'm so bored.
Bob, shut up. Right now. They told me to tell this story.
I want to hear it.
Yeah, Pete. Are you kidding me right now?
No, thank you, Pete. We're
good, we're good. Seriously, Pete?
No, we're good.
Finish.
No.
I'll finish.
I'll be in the bathroom.
The old man, that asshole. The old man beached the rig on a curb. The hydrant was blocking the front of the house. He put the house on the curb, hit the hydrant beautifully, like a geese would. And he took me and he's like, come here. 136 truck pulled up. He put me in 136, and he's like, sit here, don't move. Now, mind you, my dad knew if he had Tommy or Bobby, he knew if he told them, sit here, don't move, they wouldn't move. But Ronnie, he'd be like, oh, fuck. I'm
so
totally
you took it
screwed.
Out of PTO?
I'm totally screwed right
so
now.
So you took the rig out of
I
PTO?
Got my the worst son, first new job, I tell him to sit here, he's naturally going to move.
Pulling the outriggers up.
Well, I'll tell you right now,
bro. I don't think this is in the right spot. Let me just slide it up just a couple feet.
And this is the fire story. I don't tell fire stories, but it was blowing out the second floor, blowing out two windows, and I sat there. And I'll tell you right now, and I was in 136 rig, and the old man fucking hit the hydrant, put me in the rig.
I never heard that story.
Rolled up the window.
Where are you working now?
Shut up, idiot. And he said, "Sit here, don't move." And I sat there. And
did you actually sit there?
I sat there because once in a while I actually did listen to my dad.
Uh-huh. Where's he working now?
And
I don't know.
And I will remember this. And I'll remember this because it'll affect me for the rest of my life. It was such a good job, first new job, that I sat there and the window of the rig, of 136 rig, got hot. And I was like, holy shit, they're in there. And this the window of the rig is hot. And whoever 136 chauffeur was that day, I will never remember,
if you're listening, thank you, opened the door and said, who the fuck are you?
As he should.
Naturally. And I was like, I'm riding with 288. My dad's driving 288. And he's like, okay, slam the door in my face.
No shit.
No shit. That's swear good. To God. The window that was rolled up by my sure. dad was actually hot from that job.
That's a good story.
Really? And my old man, Beach 288, like an engine, like squad should be, but my, like an engine.
Oh. You know, I knew it was too good to be true.
And it was
so good for so long.
It was so good for so long.
And he was probably like, fucko. Sit here and don't move. And I didn't move.
Didn't.
Not many times in life.
Why are you screaming? What? Is that how you act when you're at a job? We're talking here. It's okay.
I'm a screamer.
He's a screamer. He's amped up. He's amped up. I got it. I know. He's
a breath.
When he lost, oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, easy, easy. Take it easy. Nice and easy.
Oh, look.
Take it. Take it.
103, 290. That comp.
Yeah.
Oh, you had a 290
at a flip.
That's why
screaming.
I would have went.
At a flip. You don't see me screaming.
Nope. 290 at a flips.
290.
Look at your mother's face right now.
Oh, Louis Inferno. Congratulations. You got promoted to lieutenant. Oh, you want to go 290? You got to stop.
You want to know the story?
I want to know the story.
Tell us the story.
Tell us the story.
Tell us the story, man.
You know, I want to do what your mother wants.
Tell us.
So, Chief Coward, which, again, I've told the story. If you're a black guy on the FDNY in the 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000s, with the last name Coward, you would think to yourself, holy shit, right? I mean, it's 99% white, but he was my favorite guy on the job. He was my captain in 117. He got promoted to chief. He went to the 5-2, I believe, in Long Island, and then he went to the 3-9. So I got assigned to the 5-7 battalion. I was bouncing around 102, 235, 119, and after about 6 months, I got promoted in June of 02, right after 9/11. So about 6 months into it, he calls me and says, oh, it's Chief Coward. You know, he was Lewis. It's Chief Coward.
Lewis.
Yeah, always straight name. Never
professional.
Yeah, always. So I said, hey, Chief, what's going on? He's like, listen, I got a spot for you if you're interested. I said, yeah, whatever you think. He's like, you know, I got a spot in 290 for you. Yeah. I'm like, really? I'm in. I'm like, yeah, I'm definitely in. I'm like, well, am I going to go UFO there? Like, what am I going to do? He's like, no, you're going to get the spot there. I'm like, oh, great. I'm like, wait a minute. Nobody wants to go there? He goes, without batting an eye, he goes like this. Nope, nobody wants to go there. He goes, but I will tell you this. It will be a good spot for you. I think you will fit in well there. And you know what?
You did.
I did fit in well there.
It was, you would fit in anyway.
It's a tough kitchen. It's a tough place.
I would fit in. I got detailed to 103 one night.
That's where I should have went. Hold on. I got a good 103 story.
No. We're not talking about 103.
What do you mean?
No,
we're talking about the old man.
290.
No. We're moving on.
We're moving on. Let's move on.
Yeah.
What do you got?
So I want to hear from your mother. I want to know. Unfortunately, we're going to have to talk about, we talked about this before. We're going to talk about the day. We're going to try and skim through it a little bit. And then we're going to talk about these nitwits, where they are now, what they're doing. So just so I know, I've never talked to you about this. I mean, I know we've dealt a lot. I was a union delegate then. You know, we were spending a lot of time down there.
Met you down there, remember?
Yes, I do remember that. So we're going to talk just a quick, brief thing about that day. We'll try and keep it... you know, you guys said you'd be willing to do this, so we'll keep it as quick as possible. So that day, obviously, you know.
Well, you told it. You said we're going to keep it quick. Cooper said, why are we going to keep it quick?
Well,
I did. So
okay.
We got this, Cooper.
We do.
We got this.
We can pull this.
There's no tears. No tears.
The night before 9/11, Tommy had problems with the computer. He got a death threat on the computer. So I, of course, was terrified all night. The next morning, Ronnie and I got up and went for a walk, 6 o'clock in the morning, talked about it, came home, and he called me from the car.
He was going
actually,
to work.
Prior before that, we were in the kitchen, came home from our walk. He went up and got showered. I made coffee. Ronnie went out the back door, like he always did every morning. I handed him his coffee, cup of coffee, told him, I love you. See you when you get home. He's supposed to come home that night. For some ungodly reason, I went to the front door, opened it, scared him as he was walking down the driveway and said, I love you. I'll see you tonight. Never did that. he turned around and said to me, I'll see you tonight. And I watched his car go down the block. And then we were talking his whole way into 288. We were talking on the phone.
About him.
About Tommy. I had a daycare at the time. I had kids over. My brother Chris called me and he said, put on CNN. I'm like, get out of here. The kids are eating breakfast. I'm watching Sesame Street. Put on CNN, Carol. I want you to see something. And I saw that the first tower was hit. My gut reaction was, oh, well, at least I know where Ronnie is now. Squad, I knew, would do those kind of things. Then I saw the second tower get hit. And I said to my brother, this is no accident. Something's terrorism or whatever. That afternoon, oh, the kids were notified through. One of my neighbors went and picked up Bobby. I remember that. Ronnie came home.
Ronnie was home.
Tommy was on the train.
Tommy was on the train. Tommy was on the train and Ronnie was home sick. I was in second. I was in second period. In my first ninth grade year, freshman year. And they made an announcement and they said that the Twin Towers were hit with a plane. We're going to delay third period. And I will be honest, I did not know what the Twin Towers were. I knew them at the World Trade Center. And I was like, what's going on? And they said they were going to give us 15 extra minutes to get to third period. I went to the back doors and I saw my, you know, as we know, my father was a baseball coach. I went to the back doors in the 12th. I was ninth grade in a 12th grade school. I was a 13-year-old with some 18-year-old kids. And at the back, I saw these 18-year-old kids like miserable and throwing their phones and crying. And I was confused. I truly didn't know what was going on. And I saw a close friend of mine, Chris Medici, threw his phone against the wall. And I said, oh, man, something's wrong. So I called home and I said, Ma, what's going on? She said, maybe you should come home. You know, I didn't hear from Dad. And Ronnie was home sick and Tommy was on the train going to school.
Hold on. That morning when Mom and Dad left at 6 a.m. for their walk, I woke up and I was like, oh, shit, this is a good day to fake sick. Mom and Dad left. I'm going to wake up with a fake headache. School's a joke. When Dad and Mom came home for their walk, they came into my room, or Dad came into my room, and I was like, Dad, I got a wicked headache. And he's like, listen, I got to work. Deal with Mom. Naturally, I was like, oh, deal with Mom. That means I got the day off. So Dad gave me a kiss, and he's like, I'll see you later. Because like we said,
never said goodbye.
Dad never said goodbye. And I hate everyone listening right now because I'm not a mushy guy. But Dad never said goodbye. He always said, see you later. And I was like, oh, see you later. I was like, this jackpot. You know, I don't have to go to school today. So Mom came in. And I was like, oh, I got a headache. She's like, oh, yeah, no big deal. You stay from school today. And then this is where the story continues, Bob.
And I went to school that day, second period. I was in my English class, my first couple days of high school. And I heard all this nonsense going on. I called my mom and I said, I don't know what's going on. And she said, maybe you should come home. And I said, okay, fine. And I found a friend of mine, my friend Ted, our friend Ted. And I said, my mom said I should come home. You want to come home with me? He goes, sure. So we started walking home. We went home. And I remember the day like it was yesterday.
Me too.
And I went home. I walked home. My mom was home. Ronnie was home sick. She had some kids at the house. I remember going to Smith Street Deli, and I got breakfast like nothing was wrong. And I remember all these people, all these adults coming in, and they were buying beer. And they're like, oh, we're going home. Oh, we got sent home from work. And I'm like, what is going on? Like, why is everyone going home from work? Why is everyone buying beer at 10, 11 o'clock in the morning? Like, what's going on? And I went home, and from then on, I didn't go back to school for many, many weeks. I mean, obviously, we waited home. After a couple days, I realized you know, dad wasn't coming home. And from there, we
so from there, faking sick, which is exactly what I did. My mom came in the room and she woke me up and she's like, turn on the TV. And I'm like, all right, I'll turn on the TV. And she's like, look what just happened. And I'm like, holy shit. I put the TV on. Now, mind you, I faked a headache. And I'm like, oh, wow. And now the craziest thing in the world, and, you know, no one believes in this shit. And naturally, I don't believe in this shit either. But, mom, if you could you remember what I had next to my bed? I had an 8-ball.
Oh, that's right.
A magic 8-ball.
You did have the magic 8-ball. Yes.
So my mom wakes me up and she's like, listen, some crazy shit's going on in Manhattan right now. She's like, wake up and watch the news. So I put the news on and I see it. Now, I'm old enough to understand, like, holy shit, my dad's at work. He's in Mass. I can't pronounce that.
Maspeth.
And I'm like, all right. So I put it on. And I'm like, wow, that's some fucking, that's crazy shit. You know, like a plane just hit a tower. Accidental? Is it terrorism? Right. And the first thing I do, and listen, millions of people will be like, oh, he's bullshitting.
He's not.
I'm not. I grab my 8-ball, my magic 8-ball, and I'm like, holy shit. Like, my whole life I relied on this stupid magic 8-ball, and I shake it. And I'm like, my mom's like, oh, dad's at work and crazy shit's going on in Manhattan. I'm like, that doesn't work, Manhattan. Big deal.
Right.
And I shake thought
the same thing, actually.
And I shake the fucking 8-ball. And I look at it and I look, and I'll remember it to the day I die. It's like, whatever it said, something about doubtful. Mm. Its results will be doubtful or whatever it is doubtful. And I'm like, all right, no big deal. Then later in the day, you know, we slowly start to understand that he comes home from
school.
He comes home from high school, and he comes home from college, and
he didn't come home.
He came home for a while because he got stuck in Manhattan.
Got stuck in Manhattan.
Because after this all happened, he gets stuck in Manhattan, and you ended up in Brad Beckerman's apartment.
I'll give the story in a minute.
So he ends up in like a family friend's. Like an extended family friend's apartment because everything was shut down.
In Manhattan.
And now I'm like, holy shit, I faked sick today. And now this fucking stupid 8-ball's telling me my dad's knocking up. Bad news. This idiot's home. This idiot's stuck in Manhattan at someone's apartment. And mind you, the guy whose apartment he's stuck in is some penthouse in
overlooking the Trade Center
with our Aunt Joe, who's my mom's best friend. Who happens to be, her husband is here. Her husband's a fireman, senior man at 308.
308. You were supposed to go to 308.
I was.
You know, just the timeline is so crazy. Like when you look back on it,
I woke up that morning. It was probably day 4 or 5 of college. Got on the train in Merrick with actually someone Ronnie worked with, Chris O'Brien, who was one of my very good friends. We took the train in.
OB, how you doing?
We took the train into Manhattan. We had like just met as friends through the girl I was dating at the time. And as we're on the train to Manhattan, you hear everybody on the train like gasping. Like they can't believe it. And when you looked out the window, the plane had just hit the Trade Center. And you could see it from the train. So we get all the way into Manhattan, get off at Penn Station. I'm like, what do we do? And hindsight being 2020, we should have walked across the track and came right home. But you were kind of just like, how big could it be?
It was like a Cessna or something.
Yeah, what are we going to do?
What was going on?
So we went up to school, and I remember we got to school, went up the elevator to the cafeteria. He's like, yo, let's just go see what's going on in the cafeteria on the TV. By the time we get to the cafeteria, the second plane had already hit, and standing in the cafeteria, the two of us watched the first tower go down. So I remember looking at Chris and being like, I got a bad feeling, man. My dad's at work. I was like, I got to get to a phone. I'm going to call my mom, tell her I'm okay.
And then we got to work our way home. His father was in the either the Glacier or the Carpenters Union in the
Glacier
city.
Union.
Glacier Union. And he was going to go meet his dad and get a ride home from his dad. I had my, I'll never forget, I had my baseball bag with me because I was trying out for baseball at John Jay. And so I made my way to a phone after probably
a
an hour.
Long time.
Because the phones were all down. I got in touch with my mom. My mom's like, your Aunt Jody is working at such and such. Go and meet her in the lobby of that building. So we go meet her. By the time I got to my Aunt Jody, my mom had spoken to my uncle, who got us to a family friend, Brad's apartment. So by the time we get there, he's in a penthouse apartment in Manhattan, takes us out onto the his like veranda overlooking.
How far is that?
It was in the 30s.
No shit.
And now we're looking downtown, and it's gone. And just he's like standing there. Like it was just there, and it, like he was, he couldn't comprehend what was going on. And I gotta be honest, I'm like staring at downtown, like,
it was crazy.
Where'd they go?
Yeah,
like, how the hell does that even happen?
Yeah.
And so then with that, there was, they made like, I said to my aunt, we gotta like make our way back to Penn Station. Eventually, they're gonna let us get out of here somehow. We just gotta be there when it happens. So we walked back to Penn Station. And I remember they were making announcements. This is like at 4 o'clock in the afternoon now. And they're like, we're going to run one train on each line to Long Island. And I remember saying to my aunt, just grab my backpack and we're getting on this train. And she's like, what are you going to do? I go, anything we have to do to get on this train, we have to get home. And I remember a cop was standing at the top of the stairs and we were like right there. We had like weaseled our way all the way up. And I said to the cop, I'm like, hey, my father was working. I go, he's a New York City fireman. Have you heard anything? And I never forget, the cop looked at me and my aunt straight in the face and goes, there's hundreds of dead cops and firemen. I was like, well, listen, my dad was working. He's in special operations. I got to get home. The cop said, do everything you can to get on that train or you're going to be walking over one of the bridges. And it turned out that was 100% true if you didn't get on the train. Right. So we ended up getting on the train. I'll never forget. Like, it looked like something out of, like, India when the people are piled on one of those buses. This is, like, 4:30 in the afternoon. Yeah.
Can I – before you keep going, though, we've heard a lot about our stories. You guys were fortunate not to be working that day. What did you guys experience that day? You know, we obviously knew our dad was working. We worried, you know, he was there. Maybe he wasn't there. We didn't hear from him.
Yeah,
you guys were – you guys were new guys in 288. And, you know, that company was like a family. I knew it was a family for the first 3 years of just hearing from my dad. I was young. I didn't go to work with my dad as much as they did. But I knew what the company was. And I knew it after 9/11. I used to go on the website. And I used to see the brotherhood and the slogan you guys have,
Fortuna's in a bus.
Fortuna's in a school.
And I used to.
How you doing?
I used to hear the song you guys used to.
Fortune favors the brave.
Yes, and I remember that till this day, 19 years later, I used to cry to that song. When you guys were home, you guys were in the firehouse. So we knew what it was like to be home as family members. And it was tough. Obviously, we knew our dad was at work. For some strange, weird reason, our dad said goodbye that morning. Never did they go for walks. They went for walks that morning. He said goodbye. You know, I was young. I didn't know what I wanted to do. Ronnie didn't want to know knew what he wanted to do. Tommy wanted to be a fireman. He was selling being a fireman to Tommy. We know that story, but that day –
did you
when
know?
It happened, what happened?
I didn't know.
When you guys, when that morning, did you?
Tell us
your story that day.
By Carol Murphy.
Googs, where were you?
I was supposed to work that day. And I was doing personal training on the side. And what happened was.
You work out.
No.
You have muscles?
Not bad.
You have muscles?
Not bad. Job. Good recovery, man.
The two ladies I was training said to me, though, because I was working so much all the time, like, if you don't train me, I have to get another trainer. So what happened was I called the firehouse and I said, listen, I'm supposed to work that day, but can somebody cover that tour for me?
Called me.
I called him.
That Sunday.
Right. And somebody else picked up my tour.
Joe Hunter.
Right. So I was supposed to go into the firehouse, but I went to train like 6 o'clock in the morning. I went to train these two ladies. And I was in between training sessions. I was sleeping in my car, and some guy came out and said, "Listen, those guys, they bombed us. Those bastards bombed us." So I came back into the gym, and I saw on the TV that there was some kind of shit going on at the Trade Center. So I just got my drove my car to the firehouse. And because 288, you can see the Trade Center.
From the firehouse.
Yeah.
Right. From the kitchen. It's on a hill. Looks, yeah. You could see right. The whole
so
thing.
I saw it. I was like, holy shit. They're not going to be able to knock this fire down. So I went to the firehouse, waited for Captain Evans and some other guys to come to the firehouse. And
at that point, it was Captain Evans.
It was Captain Evans. Yeah.
Evans, yeah.
Captain Murphy.
I called him on the phone.
Oh, yeah.
And he said he was on his way back in because he just left. And we took the second piece. Into
the bread truck.
Yeah, it was the bread truck.
The truth is, though, that's God living.
Yeah, it's all luck in the draw.
That's luck in the draw. And you know what? My dad was on overtime that day, and he wasn't supposed to be working.
My old man took Garasta that day.
And he,
for the fire.
That's no pro or con for anybody, but you know what?
Oh, it takes a long time to get over that, bro.
I can't imagine.
My old man worked
a long time to get over that.
You know what's really funny?
It ain't no easy. You know, it ain't no easy. It's easy now.
Getting over what?
Able to not
being here and somebody else ain't here because
so crazy.
You know, Kevin called me to work that day. I was working Sunday. You talked about that day being at the firehouse that morning. He called me to work, but we all had side jobs. Ronnie was a construction guy, right? He was a carpenter. You know, I had a Tropicana wrap. So that day I said, you know, I can't do it today. I got to be on the truck that day. I haven't been on the truck in a week.
It's funny.
Well, we didn't know till very late in the afternoon. Well, we got a first call from Carol Murphy, the captain's wife, saying we don't know if they made it into Manhattan. We don't know which side of the bridge they're on or which if they've got through the tunnel. Hours later.
It was hours.
Hours later, she called and said, we've been notified they're in Manhattan.
They're actually... We were initially notified by
was Carol Murphy?
We were told by they're on the missings list.
That was where now they're on the missing. That came later. That came later.
That's like
11
o'clock.
But at this point,
I was on the missing list.
By this point, there were so many people in our house, family, friends, everybody just came, and you just waited, and you just waited, and you watched things on TV. And I'll never forget my nephew, Christopher, who's now a Marine, was there.
Semper Fi.
And he's watching TV. Everybody was. And they saw Ronnie walking down the street.
Yeah, we have that picture.
Now, I never saw it.
Let's see that video.
There it is.
Pete.
There it is.
Pete, on the spot. How you doing? We got a drink to that, Proby Pete.
There you go, bro.
Trouble. You know what? That picture says that.
Nobody wanted me to see it. They'd bring me out of the room or whatever.
That picture says everything.
Finally, my nephew at 2 years old said, well, whatever, he was four, Aunt Carol should see Uncle Ronnie.
And he was prepared. And he showed me. They were all ready to go to battle.
He showed me. And as we watched it, your initial reaction was, as a wife, he's ready to work. He's going to work. He didn't look frightened to me. He didn't look scared. He looked determined.
Yeah, he does. Even in those pictures, Captain Murphy was the first one to post it. He printed that picture out, and it's in the firehouse.
Is it?
But you could see, if you look at the faces, right, you could see.
Determination.
That's Ronnie Kerwin.
This determination slash.
No fear.
Like.
Oh, shit.
What the fuck?
Yes, 100%. Like,
this is something that, you know, we don't really go to. You know what I mean?
It's just like Kevin said before. Like, they're not going to be able to knock that.
They're
it's
not
amazing
gonna be, you
how
know,
all of
you
us
know,
think that,
right,
though.
You know.
Like, everybody looks like I look at it now as a fireman. I'm like, and
that day,
it's crazy.
That day, I was delivering juice. I was in Westchester. I walk into a bodega, and I bring the juice in, and there's a woman watching the TV. And I look up, and I'm like... It's just the first plane, right? I'm like, holy shit. Like, that's not like, she says, oh, a plane hit. I'm like, that's not like a Cessna, right? I'm thinking, first I thought a Cessna. She says, oh, a plane hit. Then I look at that. I'm like, what the hell is
that? That's got to be a big plane.
By the time I went to the next, like, we dropped off the juice. I went to the next place. And second plane hit. And I told my guy, I had three or four big stores I had to deliver juice to. I'm like, let's finish this to two stores, and I want to head back. This is before anything was really right. even happening.
Right.
I just had this feeling like this don't look good, you know? Not that even we would be there. I don't even remember if I called the firehouse, right? Because usually we'd call the firehouse and say, what the fuck's going on, you know? Mm-hmm. Right.
Craziest part, back to the Matt J. Bowl.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, you wouldn't even think, you know? So I call up. We drop off the juice, and now we're heading home. And I'm listening to 10-10 wins.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy says that the building collapsed, right? The first one. And I think power. To myself, in my mind, and I'm a fireman for 6 years, mm-hmm. 7-8 years, that just
time
the
dropped.
Top,
right.
The top fell off.
Who thought it was?
Right? I would have right. never thought. And then by the time I got to Whitestone, which is where I lived with the truck, because that's where the depot was, they said both towers had collapsed. So I got home. My wife was there. I'm like, I'm going to the firehouse. I don't know what's going on. I called the firehouse. They said that they had gone, both hazmat that's and the squad gone. Had gone there. I get there, and now I see helmets are all gone, right? If you came in here and you noticed, you know, Papadopoulos and Donahue uh-huh. and Fabian, you know, all these guys were all gone. All the helmets were gone. The gear was gone. There was nobody. I got there kind of late, right? Mm-hmm. The towers had collapsed already. So we ended up a city bus pulled up, and I jumped on with, I don't even know, 10 guys, 20 guys. And they went, they made us go through. We were there in 10 minutes. I mean, it was like incredible. And the first guy I saw was Joe Iovino. He was a senior man in hazmat. He was on the back of the rig. And I didn't even realize the severity of it. I didn't really think, even all the way to that point, I didn't think that it was that, yeah, I didn't think it was that bad. And when I saw Joe, I could see it in his face. He looked at me, and I'm like, Joe, what's going on? Where is everybody? Where's the squad? And he's like, he was speechless. This is Joe, like Iovino. Like, he was a cool, mm-hmm, you know, he's a sweet guy, you know? He said something like, you know, they're all gone. I'm like, what? He's like, and then we walked up through, you know, you see on the West Side Highway, you see guys walking through the dust, right? You see guys carrying bottles. That's what we were doing, carrying air bottles, right? We're walking up. Everybody's walking up, and we're getting close to the – now I start to realize – now I'm looking at the buildings, right? And I'm thinking to myself, you know, my first thought is, holy shit. Like you can't even fucking clean this up. You know what I mean? Like, how, I mean, I can't even believe this is still – you know, we had it clean in a year, right? And I saw Jerry Murphy, and I saw a couple of guys from the squad. And as soon as I got there, he turned and looked right in my face, and he gave me he gave me like one of these. You know, it chokes me up even now thinking about it. Like, he just gave me a, you know, no good. You
I
know,
couldn't
like,
look at Jerry for the longest.
Yeah,
time.
Yeah, and he don't say much. You know what I mean? Like,
I remember
tough.
Here
that was tough for me.
They
Jerry.
Were sending Long Island departments in, obviously,
yep.
to help.
Right, they did that.
Everyone here, I remember we were hanging out here, you know, a lot, and I had literally become a member like 6 months before, and I remember everyone here like, ah, your father's in a void, some poor probie sitting next to him
we
tying
all,
knots.
I mean, we saw it. We all did that.
So then,
and having coffee down
so right. then yeah. maybe two nights later, they went in and they were going to stand by in a city firehouse. And on the way in, they got redirected to the Trade Center to dig. And they came back. And from that day forward, I don't think a single guy here was like saying he was in a void anymore.
Do you remember when I came in?
I don't remember.
I came in I got brought in by a cop car, a special friend. And I was with my brother, the priest from here. And honestly, I don't remember who else. And I met up with you guys. We got out of his car and started walking toward the mess. And you guys were right there. I was like, there's the guys from 288. So we walked over to you, and you guys walked me around. This was less than 10 days after. You guys walked me around, pointing everything out. And this is where the South Tower was, and
right.
this is where the North Tower was. And I can't believe you don't remember this. And every time you went this way, I went this way. Then you guys would go that way and tell me, but I would go right back to that same spot. And I remember saying to my brother,
this is where he's over here.
There's no voids.
Yeah,
they're not having coffee. I now know what it's like to be a widow. Mm. Ronnie's not coming home. And we picked up, I still have the bucket, and we picked up some dirt and rocks and saved it. And you were very emotional when we did that. And when we found out a long time later, that spot was where stairwell was in South Tower.
Yeah.
And that's where Ronnie was found.
The three guys.
Stairwell of South Tower.
I'm gonna take it here. We all know it, exactly how hard it was after September 11th, and it sucked. And I'll be honest with you. I have a text here. I asked somebody. I remember exactly that day. I used to call his cell phone for weeks, 662-4190, to see if you would answer. Okay?
That was his cell phone number.
And I'm going to take it from here.
There is a person.
And
that's a good story.
And I'm going to take it from and I'm going to say this.
That's a good story.
I called that phone, and I called. There was a number of 308, and I remember it ended at 6288 because that was the engine that ended in the firehouse. Did you find that? Did you find anybody yet? And I remember that, and the answer was no, and it sucked. But you know what? Dad passed, and he did exactly what he loved. And he loved teaching all you guys exactly what you love doing. And the truth is, my brothers were extremely fortunate to follow in his footsteps. And Tommy was fortunate enough to be the valedictorian of his class. Yes. And he was lucky enough to get 10. No. Listen, and I'll be honest, we were all lucky enough to get 10 extra points on our test. And Tommy got into the class as soon as possible and was valedictorian. He got the firehouse he wanted.
Hold on.
And Ronnie went to a excellent firehouse. And not only because they went to fire duty in East New York, because I will tell you.
Is that where this is?
Yeah, East New York. And I will tell you, those group of guys.
Not Astoria.
No, and I'm not here to pull tears or nonsense. But those guys treated Ronnie, Captain Seville, Lieutenant Curley, and every senior guy in that firehouse treated Ronnie like a son. And I learned to love 175. I did. And that's why I hated that Ronnie got promoted. I said, don't leave those guys. Those guys are the best. No, that's the greatest firehouse in the entire
Curley,
bar
right?
and everything. Curley.
Big Curley, right?
He is the greatest guy in the world. He treated Ronnie like a son, Lieutenant Curley
Still
and
does.
All of them.
Still does.
And listen, I regret, there's regrets in my life that I didn't become a city fireman. But they did, and they followed great footsteps.
When Tommy got on the job, Tommy is the first son of anyone to ever die in our
legacy. The legacy.
Yes. Yeah.
I was in a group with, there were three of us in the class, but we were the first ones. I graduated.
If you ever actually I'm not all about the mushy shit. So
we're going
to
get past the mushy stuff. We're going to stop breaking your fucking
Hold on.
We're going to make it funny. I want to bust their balls.
We're going to make it funny.
When
Tommy got hired,
Lieutenant,
right?
Can you call in?
When Tommy got hired, right? Tommy was the first son of any legacy to get hired.
What year was that? 2004?
Tommy got hired in 2004.
Time drop.
How you doing?
Mad time.
Yo, Pete, you
it's
should
almost
have,
time
like,
to retire.
Pete, you should have like a time drop.
Wait,
like,
wait. Pete, you're a fuck up.
Oh! That was a long time.
Yeah, it's a little slow.
So when Tommy got hired,
and Kevin's a fuck up.
Kevin's a fuck up.
All right, take it easy. Don't panic.
When Tommy got hired, right? It was
I can't feel his face.
It was Kevin. it was perfection. Tommy got hired. The old man died on 9/11. So 9/11 was 2001. Tommy got hired in 2004. First son of any legacy to get hired. And I gotta be honest, I don't compliment him much. But if there was any person to ever be hired by the first legacy,
that was the guy.
Yep. That's the guy.
You got it.
Okay, that's a guy.
He's not great at much.
He's not great at much, but he's fucking.
He's a good fireman.
Yeah, he's a good fireman.
He got a couple medals.
He's real good at
this. I was
going
to wear them all tonight, but they didn't match my shirt.
Yeah, I know. You would have been leaning on your
mouth. And my uniform's
like
tight.
They were up and hanging on.
Very tight. I got to shave back.
You do. So, when Tommy got hired, naturally, and listen, he got hired in 04, I got hired in 08. Same shit.
I'm still waiting to get hired.
They all show up. The Post, the Daily News, the Newsday, they all show up. And then they're looking, oh, we got to take pictures. We got to put in the newspaper. You got hired. Your dad died. Your old man died on 11.
Tommy should have went to 157.
There's a real good picture of Tommy. He got hired on 9-11. His old man died on 11. And there he is doing pull-ups, right?
It's me and the physical fitness winner of the class. Now,
and there he is.
Say that I was.
You can do a pull-up.
I don't think you can do pull-ups.
No chance, bro.
No chance of pull-ups. Don't shit on my story. There it is, the pull-up bar. Now, if you
that's all the steel.
If you go to the Rock right now, you see. Now they're not hiring right now because we won't go there. Mm-hmm. But hiring freeze. I'm getting demoted, no worries. But there it is. There's a pull-up bar. And then there's a guy doing perfect pull-ups. And then there is Tommy.
I was going to say, that ain't Tommy doing
Naturally,
look at your mother's face.
There is Tommy. He's got one arm on the pull-up bar.
Physical
hold
specimen.
Look, I gotta
you look like you got a little game. You look like you got a little game.
There's one arm on the pull-up bar. Pete, you got this?
I got this.
All right. Who's that? One arm on the pull-up bar. Give it to me. And his second hand, for some reason, it's fucking down here. And he's struggling for shit to do a pull-up.
They have
it's the greatest picture.
There's a story behind this. This is in the Post. The Post comes and does like strength.
The truth is, the truth is, I could do a great pull-up.
So
one.
Mind you, this is two. They have us do like four or five pull-ups.
Yeah, four or five.
Then they
right.
take the picture.
Yeah,
so
yeah, sure.
So, mind you, I'm with the physical fitness.
So, you're a little tired. You're a little tuckered out.
Tired. You had to do four pull-ups to graduate. As far as I was concerned, that's all I ever had to do.
But you would have felt like Victorian.
I was the brains of the
operation.
You should
be doing those with your pinky toes.
Yeah, whatever. So, the guy next to me is obviously banging them out like there's no tomorrow. And there I am. And it says geese across my back, the Proby School.
Oh,
it's the greatest photo to ever exist. Like,
where is it? You should have sent me that picture.
Dog, get it.
Whoa. Pete, you got those photos?
I have not that one.
Proby Pete, you're dropping the ball.
No.
I'll find it.
Send it to me.
I'll find it. There it is.
Listen,
Bobby Geese, valedictorian. One arm on the pull-up bar, the other arm down here.
All right, listen, I'm done talking to you guys, first of all. One, you're not that entertaining.
Yeah, my mom's so much more entertaining.
I want to talk to your mother.
Yeah, she's so much better looking.
Yes, she's much.
She is.
Let me ask you a question, young lady.
Yes, sir.
How do you feel about having your sons on the job?
Proud.
Yes.
The first word.
Yes.
Very proud.
Yeah, let's turn that.
Afraid. You know what? Ronnie went to work all the time. I never thought twice. Never thought where he was, what he's doing, what fire, or whatever. Granted, I was never a big news watcher because of that. But now I'm frightened all the time when I know when they work. If I have the news on and I see there's a fire somewhere. But mother's instinct really comes into hand because the first time Tommy got burned, it was on Thanksgiving. He wasn't on the job too long. And I was up at like 5 o'clock in the morning, 6 o'clock in the morning, and I'm watching Brooklyn Fire, Fireman Engine taking the fast phone. I was like, that's Tommy.
Really?
A couple hours later, my phone rang, and I called a friend and I said, Tommy's hurt. I know it is. I know it's him. Oh, stop. You're being ridiculous. A few hours later, Tommy calls. I don't want you to get upset or anything, but I'm in the hospital.
But
what?
My face is burnt off. I can't hear anything.
So mother's instinct really kicks in, so you're kind of frightened every time they're there and you hear a fireman injured. You don't want your head to go there.
Right.
But it does. It does a lot.
Me and you have a good bond with that.
Absolutely.
I got burned too, though.
Let's talk about Bobby.
I
got burned on Bradford Street.
I
never got burned. Second of all,
the best thing with the boys are. Shut up.
Can I always worry about these two? And I'm fortunate.
I
regret not ever becoming a fireman. I wish I did.
You were right there, right?
I was right there. It was the greatest job in the world. I should have been hired with Ronnie. I wasn't old enough.
Hold on.
And little things.
He did get hired.
And he did twice. And little things got in the way.
It happens, and that's meant to be.
And the truth is, it's meant to be, and I'm happy where I am now in life. And Karen and I, we always worry about the two of them. And you know what? At the end of the day, I wish I had that job. I sit on the side with her, and I worry about these two, and I'm fortunate for that. We're on the same team.
I'm a volley and Merrick,
and you know
I even Merrick, nervous.
I love the Merrick volleys.
I'm a fucking captain for five fucking years. Do I need to be a city fireman?
I mean, I'm a captain in the Merrick volley for five years. When I hear Merrick, I hear heavy fire.
I know it. Heavy fire duty, right?
He said, I'm even nervous when there's a fire in America.
What'd you say, girl?
Even when there's a fire in America now.
Well, I'm nervous.
Wait,
can I hold you? Kevin started drinking water about an hour ago. I don't know why.
That's because he can't feel his face.
But I will tell you this. I've made decisions in life, and I chose not to be a city fireman. There's not regrets. I idolize my two brothers for being city firemen. I wish I followed in their footsteps.
That guy, maybe.
Well, you know, every once in a while, we want to be Brad Fischer.
Sabrina.
No, I went with the Brad Fischer. I went with the 290.
Sabrina, it's okay. Put the phone down.
I went with the 290.
Pat Curley.
Sabrina. I would have been the best chauffeur in the FDNY, by the way. And I'm confident with that right now.
And you're basing that on Wheeling and Merrick?
If any chauffeur from 290, hold on.
This comes from a 290 guy.
If anyone from 290 wants to challenge me to a chauffeur competition, I'm willing to accept. I will beat you into your first Dubai.
How many drinks have you had?
76. Hold on. Prior to that, I still would have beat you in.
What'd you say? Hold on.
Whoa.
Drive fast, take chances.
Wait a second. I'm here talking about respecting them, becoming firemen, and I regret it.
Hold on. I'm a lieutenant, by the way, but not just a fireman.
You're a lieutenant?
Ronnie's a lieutenant. Yeah.
Oh, that's a lieutenant right there.
With the hat.
Salute him.
With the hair.
He had a hair.
Well, he dyes his hair.
There it is,
175. I think he dyes his hair.
Captain Seville,
you got that up? But what I will tell you is I will drive the rig better than anyone in 290.
Take it easy. Don't speed.
Or 232.
Tap the brakes.
No, I'm confident.
We don't tap the brakes, but you tap the brakes.
No, I tap them.
I want to say something.
Hold on, your mother wants to say something.
Well, Carol wants to talk. Zip it.
Must be.
Carol, talk.
One thing that really helps me with them with work, both of them usually call me on their way in.
Cat, who's the best chauffeur?
And both of them call me on the way home. Your father was.
No.
Oh! Man.
Look at Vic over there. Look at this.
Vic, my stepfather.
Hold on.
Best chauffeur that I ever seen.
Hold on. Silence for a second. If we could introduce
an amazing stepfather.
Since 9/11, our mom has met the greatest guy. And that'll come for all three of us.
Vic, the best guy we could have ever accepted into the family.
Has since remarried, and it is Vic. And we couldn't ask for a better stepdad.
I like your style.
Talk about
now I like it.
Whoa, 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 any divorces right here. We're out on
divorces.
Why did you bring that up?
Jesus
Christ.
I'm going to nine divorces in, but...
No.
Carol met Vic, and Vic is... I honestly thought after 9/11, I would never in a minute thought I'd call someone dad. And that man right there, he's here. You can't see him.
I see him.
All you crazy live buffs that are watching, that's Vic.
Can you say buff?
Can
we say buff?
Can I say buff? Coops, can I say buff? Is buff out?
Yeah. Buff's out. Vic is in.
That's our dad.
Buff's in.
My dad died in 9/11, and it took years for my mom to find someone, but since then... She found the greatest guy in the world. And Vic, come in the picture. Come over here right now before I slap the shit out of you.
Bring it in.
Vic. That's Vic. That's Vic right there. And he's fucking aces.
I think I love Vic.
Take it easy. Take it easy, boys.
You're yelling at me for...
You're screaming again. I thought a 175 guy, you keep screaming.
I apologize. Raffano got signed to 290 out of flips.
Yo, why is he going to take shots at 290?
Raffano left flips and they're like, oh, we need a guy for 290.
I love you.
I would have been
How long did you bounce for?
Why are you hating on you? I love you.
Still screaming.
I want to go to 290. I still want to go to
290. Raffano bounced for 9 days and then they gave him 290 because no one else wanted.
I think the next time we do one of these, screaming? We're not going to start drinking at 5 o'clock.
Yeah, we can't do that.
Who asked you your opinion, Pete?
Why are we picking on you?
Handsome Kobe Pete.
Hey, fuck him.
Now you're talking my language.
I'm driving, that so really I'm off the sauce.
Right, it goes right to it. Right?
It really is.
Fucking perfect. It really is. It's perfect.
I have to tell you guys that you were very, very important to Ronnie. He spoke with both of you all the time. We knew you existed at 288, how much he loved working with you guys. And
it really was
especially,
a family.
You were a family, and he spoke of it.
It don't happen often. Like, you could go to a firehouse. You know, you could get assigned to a firehouse and you become part of that firehouse.
Right.
But to have 25 guys come in brand new that don't know anything about anybody and then
really
get
a
mission. And you know what? We say this all the time. I've never had as much respect for a man as I do for Captain Murphy because the guy, it's legit, right? I mean, I've seen a lot of guys on the job, but that guy was the guy.
When I graduated probie school, Captain Murphy gave me the picture of my father that was up before walking into the Trade Center. He came to my party for graduating probie school. There's two quotes on the bottom of it, and it's basically like, they were courage quotes about how, it takes a lot to look at something, look at something and still fear it, but yet still face it. And it hangs in my locker literally to this day. And you talk about going to a firehouse and just fitting in. When I first got to Brooklyn, nobody knew who my dad was. I purposefully went somewhere where, I was going to have to make my own way. And you struggle in the beginning. You're a different kid from Long Island. A lot of guys are from Staten Island and from Brooklyn. But after a while, it's family. And, I've considered leaving and putting my paper in and transferring. And you look around and you're like, how the hell do you walk out of here? I watched Ronnie get promoted. Ronnie get promoted, and I think that's like what really changed my whole view on it.
Before you go, I'm going to say this. And Ronnie did very well on the lieutenant's test.
Now, mind you, hold on. I didn't study.
He didn't study. He took the test. He did excellent.
And naturally smart.
What's the matter with you?
Naturally smart.
What's the matter?
I'm going to go with this, and he did excellent on the test, and he got. He got called to be promoted, and I said, what the hell are you doing? You're in the greatest firehouse in the world. And I know – listen, I'm going to say this. Let me go. Please, let me talk.
Yes.
I'm going to say this right now. He was in one of the greatest firehouses in the FDNY because I knew it. I became friends with people in his firehouse. I became close with guys in his firehouse. Like no other firehouse. And I will say this not because they're listening, not because Captain.
Now go like this.
Earmuffs.
I've
never done this before.
No. I'm not going to say it because they're all listening. That's not why. I used to tell her, fuck it. Don't take it. What are you crazy? Don't get promoted. What are you nuts? Stay in your firehouse. That's the best firehouse in the FDNY. You go to fire.
You got
the best guys.
Carol Amos.
But I'm going to tell you why.
Gaza Street. Suck it.
Wait, I'm going to tell you. Ronnie got promoted for one reason and one reason only. He got promoted because my father wanted to be promoted. He was on the list.
Well, he was promoted posthumously, correct?
Yes. And
posthumously.
Ronnie,
good word.
Posthumously.
Good
word. And Shut Ronnie, it. And bef- let's stop. Ronnie got promoted for one reason. Because my father was supposed to be promoted and he couldn't.
He was on the list.
And Ronnie was promoted in his honor.
Yeah, that's good.
And that's why he did it. And not because he wanted to leave 175, because he made some of his closest best friends in 175. I begged him not to get promoted.
I told him he was out of his mind.
It was all these guys and everyone. My mom.
Listen, the bottom line is you have to move on. At some point, you have to move on. Everything changes. Everything. People move on. People retire.
Oh, Bobby Pete. Bobby Pete.
Bobby Pete.
What do you got?
What do you got?
Fellas. Settle down.
Settle down. Your mom, I want to talk to your mother because she keeps getting interrupted.
Thank you, sir.
Can you just swing the mic a little bit towards you?
Of course, sir.
I want to ask you, what are your happiest memories? What's your happiest memory of that era of the firehouse, of firefighting, as a wife of a firefighter?
From 288?
Yeah.
My happiest memory.
Meeting Nate.
Meeting Nate.
No time. Cool's with his shirt off.
You are good looking with
what's
your shirt
like,
off. What's it been like? Hold on, hold on. Let's let your mom talk. Hold on. What's it been like for you in this culture your entire life? Because I'm just getting the taste of it in the last 6 months, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's overwhelming sometimes even for me, like right now. But but no, I'm really curious to get your take on it.
They become your family, all of them. They become my best friends now. Not all of them, but a lot of my closest friends now are 9/11 widows, the wives from 288 and hazmat.
Yeah.
I mean, I was part of the fire service before Ronnie was on the city with Merrick here.
Yeah.
And they were family. We did everything together. We went to conventions together. We went on vacation together. It was great. You just lived every day within your life, but the firehouse was a part of it. Right. It just was nothing out of the normal to me.
It's like you were in there with them.
Yes. It was. I didn't fight the fires and stuff, but we heard about it. The wives were together. We would come here at Merrick and have a party, and the sirens would go off. They would leave, and we'd stay here partying. I mean,
trip you out? I mean, obviously, we know the 9/11 story, but
There was some.
You had moments?
There was some. There was a very bad accident in Merrick 1 year, and the kids and I were at the firehouse, and they lost one of their members, and things like that, yeah. But for the most part, now what bothers me more, the year before, 2 years before Ronnie died, we had a house fire. So now when
I remember that.
We lost everything. Remember that?
I forgot about that.
We spent his whole last leg. Yeah.
I forgot about
1999.
That.
1999. Our house burnt down, and Ronnie and Tommy were at school, and Dad was on his side job.
Spent his last year life building a house.
My mom took me to the doctor. I was homesick, and the house burnt down. And we got a phone call at the doctor's office that somebody couldn't come because there was a fire on Lexington Avenue. And being that mom and dad had three kids, Lexington Avenue, we were always at the doctor. They said, hey, Carol, there's a – so we went
– I called the dispatcher. And I was like, Johnny, is there a fire on my block? He's like, yes.
And we
I
we
said, is it my neighbor? Carol, get home.
Yeah,
there's nothing you can do.
Man.
Just get home safely.
And we went home.
I never heard that story.
Dad came home from his side job, and
he was brought home.
It was actually the first time. It was actually the first time in my entire life I saw my father cry.
Did he really cry?
But you know what? And I thank God till this day. I thank God.
I don't remember. I mean, I remember that, but I don't remember. I don't remember going there. Did we have
no? Von Essen came.
No, it was early. It was early.
How did it happen?
The dryer fire.
Something broke in the dryer. There was a piece in the dryer.
There
was
building parties there.
Nope.
Yeah, we demoed the house.
I remember
the last of it.
I will.
You were living in a camper outside.
Yes, I remember the camper.
Double wide.
Dude, that is so funny, man.
The old man was a total white trash.
And
we lived in the double wide.
And I'll be honest with you.
I forgot about that.
The dryer shook the camper, the trailer one night. My father literally picked it up with his two hands and carried it outside because he just had enough. He snapped. Like there was, he was not meant. We thought it was hysterical.
It was the best days of my life. I'm fortunate right now. As 32 years old, I could sit here and say the best days of my life were my house burnt down. I will say it till this day because I was fortunate right before 9/11 that I was able to rebuild my house in Merrick with my father, and I was able to pick my bedroom, and I was able to be the better son. And he used to yell at us too.
Hank was all those guys. He was subbing out the whole job, right? He was subbing out all the jobs. I remember that.
And you know what? Those were the. I was able to take those days of my life, and I remember them till this day.
and I'm thankful for it.
Abby, you want to tool belt?
Yeah, and I still till this day then? I still till this day have
this tool belt.
I live in an apartment, and I will be honest, I go down to my storage unit often, and his tool belt is my storage.
No
unit.
Shit, yeah.
Yep.
He
kept his tool belt.
I have his tool belt, and
Ronnie, dude, that guy, besides his fire helmet, that's the fucking guy. That tool belt on every day, man.
It was unreal.
As crazy as it is, I have his helmet. I have his helmet from 9/11.
That's how it's a little.
When they found,
I was there.
When they found them,
it's crazy because
the three of them.
We actually know the guy that.
There it is. Go ahead, you can put it up, Pete.
There it is.
You can put it up, Pete. There it is.
Probably Pete on the spot.
Why don't we say fuck real quick? Fuck. Are you going to stop drinking water?
No.
Then I'm done.
Can't walk.
We're almost done.
But again, my face. The family never let me speak. They never let me.
Who are they?
That they are this idiot, this idiot.
Oh, all right.
Her.
Them.
Her. They never let me.
Her.
They never let her. They never.
You I mean never, the no filter aspect.
I was never allowed to approach the public.
Well,
and imagine? It no. came to a day where.
You are.
I wonder why.
How about Sean Emil? Sean Emil participating tonight.
Luke.
What a great guy. On.
What do you got?
They never let me speak. So it's still to this day. Things went on, 9/11 happened, and Bob spoke, Tom spoke, Carol spoke.
Who the hell's Carol?
Carol's mom.
Go ahead.
That's what I'd like to
mostly known as Cat.
And
AKA mom.
I was lucky enough to get the old man's helmet. So, and it's funny because the guy that found, and you'll never remember this, but in the past days, December 6th,
2001.
December 6, 2001. Crazy story. At that point, I was a total alcoholic.
December 7th.
Not me.
December 6th.
Down goes Frazier.
It was December 7th. She'll say 7th. I'll say 6th. I was drinking in the woods, right here. Totally shit faced. I was actually hanging out with Lindsay Lohan.
That's right.
How you doing?
He was.
Well, name drops. Lindsay Lohan. If you're listening, I was hanging out with you. Lindsay Lohan. How you doing? And I came home.
Well, he's got the looks. I mean.
I got the looks and the hair. How you doing? But I was hanging with Lindsay Lohan in the woods.
Personally,
right
funny,
here.
Maybe not so much.
Maybe not so much.
Go ahead. I'm just saying.
Can
Go
I
ahead.
Finish?
Go ahead. I'm waiting.
And I'm walking
it's
down the
freaking
block.
Taking on forever.
But. Now, at this point, it's 2001, 2002, whatever you want to say. I'm 16, 17. And at this point, I'll be honest, I'm drunk.
Now,
and I'm walking down the block right here, block next door to the firehouse. At this point, it's called Lexington Avenue. I'm walking down the block and I'm drunk. And I'm like, holy shit, I'm going home. My mom's fucking all yacked up on pills because shit, 9/11 happens. My mom's all. You know,
we're going hard left now.
Oh, we're going hard left. Really? Hard left. My mom's hacked up on pills.
All right, well, we've had a great show, ladies and gentlemen. And we really appreciate you guys stopping by. We really thank everything. You guys have been great. And
you're going to be honest.
Wrap it up.
Oh,
wrap
it up.
Hey, here we go.
You told me to be honest.
It's great. That was a great story.
You told me to be honest.
That was a good story.
Go home drunk in the woods. Hang out with Lindsay Lohan.
I took a periodic panic.
Hold on.
Periodically.
Naturally, my mom's all
yeah.
Pete, Bobby, give me the mic.
Bobby,
Tommy, Ronnie.
Pete, give me the mic. It's a good story.
You got it.
And I'm coming home. Like I said, I'm drunk.
All right, you said it 10 times.
I'm walking home, and I'm like, oh shit, my mom's drunk. My mom's jacked on pills. I'm drunk. No worries. I'm walking down the dead end. We all grew up on it. It's right here.
I don't wear this.
Gev, relax. And I'm walking down the block, and all of a sudden, there I see Tommy, and I'm like, oh, fuck. I'm screwed. I'm drunk. Tom's sober. And he's calling me on being drunk. And
you were drunk.
And he grabs me, and he's like, and I'll remember to this day. He's like, it's Christmas. And I'm like, no, it's not Christmas. It's December 6th or December 7th, whatever mom says. I'm like, it's definitely not fucking Christmas. I know Christmas is December 25th.
Thank God.
And they're like, they found dead. And I will remember to this day.
You're worried about me.
That day, they found my old man's body. And we actually, and I'll give him a shout out because he's a fellow sock brother. He found the old man's body, Richie Resto.
Yep.
And I'll only say, because I will know he has no issues with me saying his name. Richie Resto found my old man's body. Yes, that day, they found whatever it was of my old man's body. And I'm walking down the block home from getting drunk in the woods, because after 9/11, I went on a bit of a bender. Naturally.
He was drunk.
And
you
Tommy,
were drunk? You were
what
drunk?
About me?
Pete,
do a noise.
How about and Pete, you're a fucko.
I'll remember you
said. So just so you know, I got the call that night. Just
Tommy grabbed me that day, and he hugged me in the middle of the block we grew up on. And he's like, they found Dad. And I'm like, September to fucking December, they found Dad? And he's like, they found Dad's body. December 6th, I'll remember. Day
intact.
I died.
It was intact.
Yep.
That word. Ooh.
December 6th, 2001.
7th.
So she calls it the 7th. I called the 6th. And it's crazy because December 6th is the same day our house burnt down.
Yep.
December 6th, 1999. And December 6th, 2001, I came home that day. Tommy hugged me and they said that they found Dad's body.
They didn't find too many people.
No.
And that's
pretty crazy.
Those were three guys. It was your father. It was Kerwin, and it was
Joe Hunter, right?
Rand.
And that day,
they called me that night, and I went down to the morgue that night to identify.
Crazy. And now they, you know how they figured it out? Our teeth. It's craziest story ever. And I came home that night, and Tommy hugged me in the middle of the block I blew up in, and
he blew up in.
And we all.
Oh, you're blowing it up.
And we all, it's crazy because if you remember, we all ended up at Walker's funeral home.
Yeah. 500 people.
And I will tell you,
and I will tell you right now, it was 3 in the morning.
It was early.
It was early.
And I will tell you,
whoever contacted us, we actually had guys. So whatever time that was, it was late at night. I don't remember the time.
But it was early in the morning.
Whatever the call was that came to me, mm-hmm. I had to go. First, we went to go.
He was recovered at 5 o'clock.
What time?
Around 5 o'clock in the afternoon.
Okay, so we went. Whoever, if Resto found him, and squad, you know, every day is different squad, right. A different rescue was there. So whoever found who, they would not take that person out. The company would go to take that person out. So we went as a company, whoever was available, we went, took the guys out. It was 3 of them. We took them out. They went in the ambulance. They went to the morgue. We went to the morgue. You know, not, I don't
that remember. Night.
And
Tommy and I were
I will
home.
Say this.
They were out.
The family, listen, at the end of the day, December 6th was
7th.
December 7th was a crazy day for the family. Our house burnt down right around that time. Our dad was found that time. And we stood in this parking lot right here. We watched him come off the parkway. We were fortunate enough to come off the parkway with a beautiful escort. And I was young. I was 13, 14 years old at the time.
Right, I made sure
and,
go find
and, all, and I will be honest with you. He went to the local funeral home. He was identified by family and my uncles from Connecticut. And they were great. They were here for us. Yeah. My uncles from Connecticut were more here for us than ever. And we had our struggles. We had our hard times. But that was the hardest time for us. But it was a year round. It was just a hard time of year for us. We experienced our house burning down years prior. We had to accept it. We had our dad disappear years and accept it. And Tommy was away at school to chase his dream to be a fireman. And Ronnie was fortunate to chase his dream to be a fireman. And not only did he chase his dream to be a fireman, he chased it to be in a firehouse that was
second to none. And I thought the best firehouse in the world was 288 because I didn't know much. I didn't know anything. I was 13 years old. I thought 288 was the best firehouse in the world. And I will stand here today and say Tommy was in N147, and he's in a great firehouse, and I bust his chops. I sit here and say, oh, now you're across from a hummus shop. And
Mimmy's.
And a coffee shop. But
Tommy works with a
But Tom, Ronnie went.
How much time do you have now, bro?
Over 16.
But Ronnie.
Drop.
How much time do you have?
But let's stop that.
12 years.
And I'm going to sit here and say, Ronnie went to a firehouse that they didn't care how much time at all at any point Ronnie had. They respected my father from the day he got there. And Lieutenant Curley and Captain Seville respected Ronnie. They put him under his belt, and they respected him as their own kid. And Captain Seville treated him like his own child, and Lieutenant Curley did also. And
yeah, you keep saying that about
time. But I turned down being a city fireman, and I chose a different life. I chose a life to chase my own dream and work for myself and prove my own. And I always loved 175 because they treated Ronnie and they treated me like their own. And they treated Tommy like he was 147.
Right. That's what I
want to
say.
Let me keep going. And in 147, treated Tommy like he was his own. And Ronnie, they treated him like a kid. And that's what I always appreciated. And I always loved as a brother that I didn't need to become a city fireman. I could chase my own dream as whatever I wanted to be. But Ronnie and Tommy were always respected and treated like they should be as a kid from the FDNY. Mm. And Tommy had his captains and lieutenants put him under his belt.
Captain
Ronnie and his lieutenants put him under his belt. And those are the regrets that I might have in life that I didn't become a city fireman. Because I look back and I say, wow, those guys treated him like they were their own brothers. And I didn't get that.
These guys are texting like maniacs.
Yeah, they're so fucking, they're such bullshit. But the truth is, I love their two firehouses. Mm-hmm. And their two firehouses make me regret not becoming a city fireman. I have my reasons why I didn't become a city fireman. And life will
mind you.
All right, listen. We're gonna wrap this up. I want to hear from your mother.
I want to hear from her.
Okay.
For the longest time, we kept hearing the word intact, intact, intact. I couldn't sleep at night because of those words. I went to the medical examiner's office, and I said to him, "I want to know what intact means. And they took me in a room and they let me read the whole report of Ronnie. His whole body was broken. Part of his head was missing.
Mm-hmm.
And then I said, I want to see. Oh, then they said, listen, we have pictures. Do you want to see them? I was like, yes, I don't understand what intact means. I don't get it. And they showed me the pictures. They said, we've never done this before, but you obviously need this. And they showed me. It wasn't Ronnie.
Yeah, no.
There's a piece of meat I can't eat anymore because what their faces and their heads look like.
I know.
But the respect I have for you guys that were digging and rummaging and looking and pulling those bodies out that were all your brothers was mind-boggling to me. I witnessed it after the fact that he was cleaned up and what have you.
Mm-hmm.
You guys did it every day for months and months. And I couldn't thank the fireman enough for bringing him home to us. It was the one thing we wanted. And Tommy and I was sitting there when the doorbell rang. And they walked in. I'm like, what are you guys doing here? In uniform. Mm-hmm. And I was like, my God, you brought Ronnie home to us. And it's all you firefighters that we have to thank for that. And I do. And like they said, Richie Resto.
There was a lot. There was a lot of guys. There was countless, countless, countless.
It was, and I respect you guys for that.
I remember then saying, I had just joined here and stuff, and wanting to be down there and helping out, and so many. Hi, how are you? So many are like you guys saying, Dad, trust me, it's not something an 18-year-old kid should be doing, and it was, now that I've gotten on and you know, you speak to senior guys who were on the job then. I thank God I wasn't on the job then. I mean, as crazy as it sounds, just the crapshoot of having possibly been working, you know, that day.
I think the worst part of the whole thing was going to – early on, we didn't find anybody, right?
Right.
So we went to the memorials because we wanted to –
which
give,
is
– which so they didn't have anything. So we went to the memorials. We had 19 guys missing in the firehouse. Yeah. We went to countless – I don't know how many, 15 memorials. Right.
And there was,
and then we started finding, and then we started finding guys. Then we started going. It was relentless, and you know we wanted to do everything for the family.
I think what I was just going to
actually dug. In the yeah. Who was the angry white man?
Oh, George Hassel.
Steve Kuba? Oh, no. I was just Hassel. I was my inside voice.
Remember him?
Yes.
Yeah. He was there.
Hassel, yeah. The bull.
And I said, can I go down? He's like, you want to go down there? And I was like, I really do. And I went down, and they gave me a helmet and a vest or something. I remember digging. And the minute I found a wallet, I freaked out. That was it. So I couldn't imagine. I was like, oh, it's a wallet. Like, yeah. Somebody that's no longer with us. And all I thought about is like, oh my God, how do you guys do this? It just freaked me out. This was a wallet. You guys were digging up people.
You know, every time you found somebody, you just hoped it was your, as much as you wanted to find any brother, right? From the job, you just wanted to find, we wanted to find our guys.
Yeah,
right?
I know.
I mean, everybody was really,
you're wrong.
Right. I mean, in the end, we wanted to find everybody,
right,
but in
you
the end, when we were digging down there and putting the time in, which was every day, 24/7,
endlessly,
right,
yeah.
You just wanted to find your guys. And we got lucky. We did find
quite a few.
I mean, I know Hunter wasn't found, and a couple other people weren't found.
Oh,
was, you know, and Mrs. Hunter was, you know,
Tess
even
Hunter.
Now I think about her, I get, you know, emotional because
she's a wonderful
I used to
woman.
Talk to her all the time, and she was just a great
what a
you know,
wonderful
Christian woman.
Woman,
you know, Irish
good
Catholic,
Christian
you know,
woman
holy Christ.
Who had
she
a lot of loss.
She lost
a child
earlier than
yeah.
that, you know, so,
and
you know, I wanted,
husband.
And he was one of my favorite guys, you know,
Joe
Hunter. And, but.
You guys were a good group of guys at 288. Very loved.
I think the way that how your house, 288, rebounded was also something that was a lot to be said. You know,
yeah, that's Coobs. That was Coobs, and
was,
you know, a lot
was,
of senior guys there that stuck it
even
out.
Even when I first got on, I remember I was on the job less than 5 years, and we had a detail going to 288.
No shit,
I swear. And everybody came to
you
me.
You know,
there,
I might
like,
even have heard of that. I don't know. I know it wasn't
there,
but I might have heard about that.
And I go, I walk in the kitchen, and I didn't have, you know, at the time they were only letting guys
that's
with five
cool.
or more years take the details to SOC. And they looked at me. They're like, listen, when you get there, just say you have 6 years. I'm like, oh, no. I was like, I won't go. They're like, say whatever you have to say. I'm like, all right.
I
went, and that was it.
You guys were the best things.
You guys were very fortunate to have you.
I'm going to be honest with you. I was fortunate that I could call that number. And I remember till this day, it ended in 6288.
Yeah.
And I
476628.
And
don't give out that no more.
Yeah, now it's being called over and over.
I remember till this day.
Allegedly, that could have been. I don't know.
I remember till this
Frank
day.
Hall.
And you guys were awesome, and
still are.
It's
good to see you.
I sit in my office till this day, and I have nothing to do with the FDNY, and I think all the time how I fucked up and I should have chased my dream to be the FDNY.
I don't hear that.
And you guys are my brothers are my heroes, and my brothers are I idolize them for what they do. And I should be chasing their dream.
That's big shoes.
And I don't. I don't chase their dreams. I chose my own
path. Big shoes ain't the word.
I chose my own path to chase and I will
look at your mother's face.
And I am so proud of you.
And
I was just gonna say, look at your mother's face.
And I tell you guys this, I will help the same amount of people as my brothers do for the dream I chase. But I wish I chased their dream.
No,
that
it's
the
path you chose. That's it. You got dealt a hand, and that's it.
There's days I sit back and I do regret it, Pete, Uncle Pete.
I'm listening, brother.
I do regret it, but there's I idolize them for what they do. And I idolize them for what you guys do.
Look at your mother's scotch over there.
And everything. But no, and she could be upset, she could be whatever.
I'm not
whatever.
Upset, and I
know.
No,
I
I'm not
them.
Telling you for that. She looks proud.
I idolize them for what my
the
brothers do, and I'm proud of them. I sit here and I say, I talk positive about 175, and
That's a firehouse I would have chased to be a dream of. I don't know where it is. It might be in Flatbush, Brooklyn. It might be in whatever, but I believe in everything my brothers do, and I wish
and I am proud
everything of they do. I believe in them.
I was going to say, young lady, do you have any? We're going to close it out. We're right around that time. Do you have anything?
Thank you.
It was good to see you guys. Yes, he was one of my favorite guys. He really was.
With my boys.
And you know what? Fucko.
Hey.
Absolutely.
Nice guys. You keep drinking water, which I'm upset about.
Oh,
it was good to see you.
So great.
It's been a long time, actually, right?
Last time I saw you was at 288.
It's been quite a maybe quite a few years. Now this guy, this potch, I see all
we're
the time.
We're done now.
That's it.
Well, so we're almost done. You know what?
We're
gonna wrap it up.
There's a few things here. All right, if you're listening to this train going off the tracks and a beautiful,
we're gonna open
on a beautiful audio podcast. Please remember that you're going to find us at youtube.com/gettinsaltyexperience. And when you do find us there, take your little digit, stick it out, hit the like, subscribe, and share button. And that's how we grow the show. Also, head on over to Instagram, of course, and you can find us at Salty Dog Inc., where Mr. Refran over here posts some of the best salty fire pictures. It even gets me fired up. And also the last minute info that you need to find out for the show. Also, if you want to support the podcast, guys, head on over to GettinSaltyApparel.com where they can find what?
The double threaded masks.
Stitch.
And we are, say it.
First do it, your old lady's box.
That's it.
All right. So since we're all still wearing face diapers, they definitely get one of those and t-shirts, hats, all the fun stuff that you guys know and love from the Gettin' Salty Apparel brand. Last but not least, guys, questions and answers, and also the road show. Let's not forget we have a road show coming up. If you guys have an interesting firehouse and interesting recipes from that firehouse, interesting community, hit us up at gettinsaltyexperience@gmail.com. And if you want to hit me up personally, I may or may not answer the email, God. I'm all over it. Just hit me up. Hit me up at gettinsaltypete@gmail.com, you guys, and I will try.
Email
Lou. He loves emails. Guys, it's been another wild night, I gotta say, and thank you all. Love you all. Thank you
guys.
God bless.
All right, boys, send us home.
No problem.
You know what to say. Come on. No, you know what?
See you at the big one, you drunk fool.
We'll see you at the big one.
Stand by.
Stay low and go, bro.
Stand by. Stay low and go, and we'll see you at the big one.
God bless. Love you guys. Thank you.